Hi, thank you very much for having me. It was nice to see in that video a number of valued community members from York, including the late Honorable Jack Layton, and other members of his family. So it's nice to always see members of the York community. I want to thank the organizers for inviting me to be here and for inviting me to speak. I always get a little bit intimidated by the notion of a keynote, so we're just going to call this greetings and comments from Janet. The rough kind of framework that I was given was to talk about students and student success and diversity and the York context, and that's easy for me, so some of you know me quite well. And I could talk for a whole long time about those issues, and I hope what you'll hear is my passion and the passion that I think is shared by many staff and faculty at York for precisely those priorities. So this notion of local to global, I think, really epitomizes York for me. So I'm going to talk a lot about my personal experience, and in part because that's the only way I know to be genuine. And in part because I hope you find it instructive, because it's honest and it's real. So I always acknowledge, so when I talk about diversity, I will always recognize that I am a white woman of privilege. But my lens on diversity is no, I hope anyway, you'll appreciate, no different. If we think about diversity and inclusivity and respect and the notions of loving and embracing one another as any other definition or quality around diversity. What I love about York is the richness of our community. So we often talk about ethnic, religious, racial backgrounds in diversity, but really, for folks like me who have a lens on our demographic, the diversity runs in a far more complex, interwoven way through our communities, students, faculty, and staff. And, you know, but a few of those kind of, that can be defined in any number of ways, but we have a really high percentage of mature learners, and then we have a whole bunch of traditional learners. We have part-time learners, and we have full-time learners. We have learners who have children, and we have learners whose parents still think they're children. They're not, but their parents still think they're children. We have commuters to campus, and we have folks who call the campus their home. And we certainly have a very wide diversity of socioeconomic, of students from different socioeconomic lived experiences on campus. So if I think about my own personal experience, I want to talk about this within the context of balancing challenge and support to achieve what a university education should achieve. So, you know, many people have different views on this, but my view is that that post-secondary education, when it works, develops educated persons. And you can define that any way you want, but for me, that's about global citizenship, and it is about the values and the capacity to love and embrace. It's about the capacity to participate in a democracy. It's about the capacity to make informed decisions, to weigh and balance evidence, to make good judgments. We know that educated people contribute in a way to society, education broadly defined. They contribute to society. You know, education is positively correlated with educating your children more fulsomely. Those, you know, educational attainment is negatively correlated with incarceration, with criminal conviction. So we know there's all of these positive associations with education. For me and my money, when education works, we're contributing to that notion of being educated. And I think that happens best when we effectively balance the amount of challenge that we put forward to students and to other learners on campus, staff and faculty included, and the support that we provide so that people can be successful. So if I think about that, so I started university 2 days after I turned 16. And were any of you 16 when you started? Because then maybe you can come up and stand beside me, because the experience was a little bit odd, I will tell you. So what happened was that I was a national level athlete, and I broke my back. And so I had gone through an independent learning experience. High school for me was a bit different. And I suddenly was confronted with this reality that everything I had worked for and my entire identity had to be rejigged on the spot. And so I don't ever remember having a conversation about where I would go to university. I went to the same undergraduate institution that my parents and my grandparents went to. And I say this kind of with a sense of embarrassment now, because thinking about what I do for a living, I don't ever remember even talking about what that would be. I just remember getting in the car and we were driving west on the 401. And I remember getting to university and I know I wasn't prepared. I was intimidated. You'll appreciate that I had spent a lot of my life since the age of about 11 on team buses, traveling with a team relatively independently from my family. And so my social skills weren't great. I was independent, but my social skills weren't great. You know what I mean? Like I was awkward. And I got dropped off at Western. And because I was so young, they put me in a faith-based residence hall that was not my faith. But I think they felt that it would make me feel safer, or that it would make my parents feel safer. And my roommate was the second youngest student enrolled at Western that year. And this woman has became and has remained one of my closest friends, and we'll talk about Natalie when we talk about support. But I was incredibly isolated. So I have this experience where I am very different. I couldn't even drive, never mind drink. And then at that point there was grade 13, right? So about 90% of first year students were of legal drinking age. And I couldn't, orientation week was entirely focused on licensed events. So I spent the whole week in orientation with my roommate, Natalie, being equally ostracized, thank heavens, not able to socialize or engage or participate. And having done exceptionally well in high school, I did not do well in school in my first year. And I reflect back on that experience and think about the absence of engagement, which we know is a means, it's a challenge for students to be engaged, and it certainly would have been a challenge for me at that age and stage. But I also didn't have the supports that were available to try and balance the challenge and support to drive my growth. And so the year was very, very difficult. And I'm proud to say that I survived that experience and ultimately graduated before I turned 19. So I still wasn't legal to go out and socialize with most of my friends by the time that I finished. But it was not a positive experience. I returned to university the next year and did another degree at a different institution. And the experience was entirely different. Even the graduate orientation at the University of Guelph was embracing. It afforded me a place. I knew what the institution was about, and I felt welcomed. The University of Guelph doesn't boast the degree of diversity and student activism engagement that York does, but it is a rich and engaged environment that felt like home for me for the first time. So when I talk to students, what saved me at Western was a very small group of women that were on the swim team, because I was still able to swim, just not at a really competitive level. And those women remain my closest confidants to this day, and my roommate. So huge challenge and enough support so that I could struggle through and get to where I needed to go. At the University of Guelph, I had an orientation. I met people in my academic program. I participated in a different varsity sport, which gave me another community, because it's where I felt at home. It's where I still feel at home. Tate McKenzie is one of my favorite places on campus. It's where I fit. But I also got a part-time job. I started teaching. And I started to identify with what I wanted to do after I finished school. And, you know, it's not irrelevant that what I started to evolve to is I didn't really want other students to have that experience that I had. And so a lot of my professional development started getting geared towards avoiding that experience for students. So diversity for me was very different than it probably is for most folks. You'll self-assess and self-identify with what diversity means for you. But I think at the end of the day, the notion of being challenged and engaging in an academic community that provides you with enough support to foster and fuel your own growth and development is the message that I want to leave you with. And I think York does this in an exceptional and very, and for my money, a unique way. So I've studied or worked at 5 different colleges and universities in Canada and the US. And as I said to you, what I love about York is the richness of our campus community. And I always find it a bit ironic. We talk a lot, you know, York prides itself on this social on our social justice agenda, and we teach students in our classrooms about difference and about respect and about social justice. We expect, and in fact are quite proud, when that manifests itself outside the classroom in ways that are respectful and predicated on the notion of embracing difference. It's a wonderful thing about the York community, and it's something that I take tremendous pride in. I think this dinner, the clubs and organizations that are on campus, the Turkish Students Association and the Intercultural Dialogue Institute specifically, are forwarding those aims. So if the notion is that engagement is part of becoming an educated person, and that engagement is fostered at the point that a student finds meaning from their point of contact with the campus, these types of organizations, these types of events, opportunities for students to talk about their lived experience, their aspirations, and what they hope the lived experience of successive generations looks like, is part of not only the challenge that we present to students, but it also becomes a part of the support. And when we get that balance right, growth happens, students are successful, they're positive, and they go on to make these indelible impressions on the world, like Jack Layton. So I hope that that speaks to your experience at York. I want to thank folks for inviting me, and I have to apologize because I have to go, but I will look forward in this venue or in other venues to meeting folks individually. I think it says a lot about you that you came to this event, that you're invested in these 2 particular student organizations. And I look forward, you know, I'm relatively new to this job, but I'm looking forward to moments of engagement with students across our community that are of a similar richness. So thank you very much, and I hope you enjoy your dinner.